Brett Wills, I've met you guys before. Steve Landis is my delegate, and I represent the Arts of Augusta, as well as my son Aaron, and people like him living with disabilities in the state of Virginia. And I want to thank all you guys, first off, for all the hard work you did last year working out the agreement to help Virginia find a better path to taking care of its citizens with disabilities. And I thank you both as my son's father and also as a taxpayer, because the solution we're working towards will allow him to live as inexpensively to his fellow taxpayers as possible. And that's something that I really find it important to restate, you know, with all things that are going on, that the waiver programs that are allowing him to live in his community and with his family are allowing him to be the cheapest consumer of services he can possibly be. And in keeping with that, I also would like to address that the settlement agreement that was arrived at does make an excellent starting point. It's wonderful not to have to negotiate from behind the line. I always have a deficit of people waiting for services. However, I do know just a simple math that if we only have the waiver slots that are guaranteed in that agreement, we're not going to keep up with our population. We're going to get right back where we started in a couple of years. So I'd like very much to hear your gentlemen's thoughts on that as to, you know, what we can do to fiscally conservative to keep that up. And also, I'd like to address, there's been much talk about the group home situation where we're going to provide, you know, more funding for smaller group homes, provide more home-like settings. I love that idea in principle. I'm not here to ask for the group homes to receive higher compensation for smaller settings. I'll let the group home owners do that. I am here as a parent to ask that if there is such legislation that allows smaller group homes to receive higher reimbursement, that the coding be very specific that they must operate as small group homes, that they can't get emergency extensions, crowd more people into them. What we're looking for is a setting that will be more like a home, less like a small institution. And that's really all I have to say on both those matters. And I appreciate the gentleman's thoughts on this.
First, let me say thank you to the parents that are involved in the process, because I think Virginia hopefully will be a model providing the most cost-effective and the most liberating system for individuals with disabilities, especially intellectual disabilities. And it should be a model because it took Virginia, as you know, a while. The mindset was you have to build bigger facilities to take care of people. Well, we all know that anybody does better if they're closer to home and if they're in a, as you said, a home-like setting. That's the direction we want to move to. Chairman Putney just appointed me to the special subcommittee, the joint subcommittee that will be looking at the agreement and monitoring and making recommendations, working with the administration related to that. So I'd be glad to talk to you further once we get into session and we see kind of where we are and what we can do. It's also another example, I think, of, as you said, for government trying to make something work better, and better not only from a fiscal standpoint, but also better for the individual, because that's what we should be about. Government ought to try to make things work better for its citizens, every citizen, whether they've got a disability or not. And so I look forward to continuing to work with you. I appreciate Vicki and Ben being really supportive of those efforts, because it's been a long time coming, and we've had to do a lot of work to try to bring people around to the idea that we don't have to have institutions to care for individuals. We can have home settings and have a lot of folks in their homes if we can get the right services and make sure they're community-based. And as I think most of you all agree, government services are at the local level. They work better. People can engage the people that are providing those services much more easy, and there's better control from the standpoint of the citizen having that control on those services. So I hope that will be the way we continue.
I sit on the State Executive Council for the Comprehensive Services Act, and I can tell you we spent the last 6 months looking at where the money goes, and we're well aware of where it needs to go. And we're trying to do some things administratively that don't require legislative process with the money we have. That's the best way for us to get increased funding in critical need areas. And there are some places. There are some places where we can move money, and we're working diligently to try to make some of that happen too.
while we do move in that direction, we have to make sure that we are diligent in ensuring that the care that those individuals who are currently in institutions receive is equal or better to the care that they currently receive. Right now, you have many individuals who it would be questionable whether they could do better outside an institution setting, which has 24-hour hospital care, dental care on site. All of these resources on site in a group home setting, you may not have that. What you want to ensure is that families have options. People have options. If people believe that they're better served at home with a waiver, wonderful. If they're better served in a group home setting, fantastic. But if their family members are disabled to the degree that an institutional setting is necessary, then that needs to be an option for families. And as we move forward, we're going to, I believe, keep one facility open at this point. It's my hope we increase that to two. But that an institutional setting is an option for those who are in the severest category of need to ensure that their quality of life is not diminished. It's just how I feel.
Sir, my personal experience in having toured some of these facilities has given me a different viewpoint than you have, but I'd love to talk with you about that privately at some point in another setting.
I had Central Virginia Training Center in my district for many years, and so I've toured it many times. One more question before we go to the back.
I'm John Hill from Waynesboro. I'm here tonight in the capacity of the board member of the Greater Custer County Chamber of Commerce. While I'm personally a constituent of Delegate Bell, I'm a direct question to Delegate Klein. At the legislative breakfast, you mentioned efforts for tort reform. The chamber is very interested in all aspects of tort reform. You mentioned one specifically that dealt with premises liability. So I'd love to have you expand upon that a little bit. I won't ask you about not shooting at all.
I appreciate that softball. I'll speak briefly because it's late. Essentially, common law, which is the law that judges create when they rule, has said that business owners are not liable for injuries that trespassers incur on their property. So if you get robbed, your business, and you get robbed, and your robber breaks his leg, he can't sue you for the cost of the medical bills for that broken leg. There's been a model, kind of a national advisory for judges, advisory group for judges, that has historically adopted that. Recently, they've made some changes that would introduce some liability for property owners. It's not mandatory for judges to follow. It's simply advisory. But there's enough concern out there that we feel in Virginia that we should go ahead and encode our common law in the Code of Virginia to protect those property owners and say, current law is what it is. You shouldn't be liable for injuries by trespassers. And then if other states change theirs based on the common law, that's their business. But we're going to be protected in Virginia. So that's what I'm seeking to do, to simply codify the common law in the Code of Virginia. So.